Vikas, I think the topic is war on trial and sessions trial, not actually summons trial.
Yeah.
Anyway, if necessary, we can just discuss that summons trial also. There is nothing wrong in it. See, good evening, my dear friends. See, today's topic is actually war on trial and sessions trial. The procedure is given in the ZRPC. I have or I cannot add anything to it or delete anything from it. Still, there is some scope for discussion, as it is in the case of every law. Even after this 50 years or 70 years, or about 60 years, the provisions in the constitution come for interpretation. So that is how actually a law grows. That is why it is said that law is not static but dynamic. If there is no question of interpretation, there is no question of the statute being called dynamic or organic. Our constitution is organic because it grows. Every act and every statute and even constitution grows with the interpretation only. Okay, so with this introduction, we shall now start. See, the word trial is not defined in the CRPC. Its meaning differs in different situations. And its meaning differs under different statutes also. Under the Representation of People Act, it may be one meaning can be given to it. But in ZR, for a trial in the, under the IPC, another meaning can be given, CRPC. Then so also under different statutes, the meaning of the trial may be different in different situations. But generally, we can say that the trial of a case, warrant case, starts with the framing of the charge. Or as the Constitution bench held it, is after the framing of charge, the trial starts. That is what in Hardeep Singh versus State of Punjab, that is AIR 2014 Supreme Court 1400, the Supreme Court, the Constitution bench of the Supreme Court has held. So ordinarily, we can say that trial of a warrant case starts with the framing of the charge. But in a summons case, it is different. Once the plea is recorded, then trial, that is the particulars of the offenses are read out, then trial starts. Instead of charge, particulars of offense, the substance of the particulars of the offense is read out. That is the difference. Okay. So under the court, there are four types of trial. They are sessions trial, warrant trial, summons trial, and summary trial. But none of these terms are defined in the court. But it can be seen from the court that there are two definitions which require notice in this connection. They are warrant case and summons case. So these two terms are defined in the CRPC. Though the trial, the word trial or a sessions trial, warrant trial, summons trial or summary trial is not defined. So the words, let us see the meaning of the word warrant case. Defined in section 2, that is in the dictionary in the CRPC, section 2, yes. Warrant case means a case relating to an offense punishable with death, imprisonment for life, or imprisonment for a term exceeding 2 years. So that means even a murder case is a warrant case. A rape case is a warrant case. So any offense, the punishment of which exceeds imprisonment for 2 years, then it is a warrant case. It is a settled one. There can only be dispute regarding it. It is not up to 2 years. It is exceeding 2 years. So it should exceed 2 years. But summons case also is defined. Summons case means, that is section 2W. Summons case means a case relating to an offense, not being a warrant case. So all cases other than warrant cases are summons cases. It means if all the cases, the punishment of which is imprisonment up to 2 years or summons cases. So there are only two types of cases under the CRPC. They are warrant cases and summons cases, though there are four types of trial. So how can we explain it? So that is the question before us. The procedure for trial or summons cases by the magistrates is prescribed in Chapter 20 of the Code. So Chapter 20 contains the procedure for trial of summons cases. This does not mean that that is the only procedure for trial of summons cases. See, a different procedure for trial of summons cases also is prescribed. That you can see in Chapter 21 in the Code. See, it is a summons case and the trial is a summons trial here. But a different procedure is prescribed in Chapter 21. It is called actually summary trial. So some warrant cases also may be tried according to this. Some warrant cases also may be tried as summons cases or summary trial cases. According to the procedure prescribed in Chapter 21, that is a summary trial. That is offenses under Section 379, 380, 381, 411 and 414, where the value of the property does not exceed 2000 rupees. So they are treated as minor cases. The value of the property is less, maximum 2000 rupees. But the summary trial is modified. All these terms are punishable with offenses for a term exceeding 2 years. Now, sections 454 and 456 IPC. They are also warrant cases. The punishment exceeds imprisonment for more than 2 years. So they are also warrant cases. Still, they also may be tried as under the procedure prescribed in Chapter 21 for summary trial. So there are some all summons cases may be tried as under the procedure prescribed for summary trial. And some warrant cases also may be tried according to the procedure in Chapter 21 as summary trial. Now, summary trial, we can see what is the difference. Summary trial is a modified or simplified form of summons trial. So the basic trial is a summons trial. Summary trial is a modified or simplified form of trial. Summons trial. Summons trial is prescribed only for trial by magistrates. So see the heading, Chapter 20. When you see the chapter, you can see it. How it starts. Chapter 20, trial or summons cases by magistrates. So, it is applicable only to a trial being conducted in a magistrate court, not elsewhere. So the section 256 also reveals it. Since a summary trial is a simplified form of a summons trial, it is applicable only to trial in magistrate courts. So it means that both summons trial and the summary trial can take place only in a magistrate court, not elsewhere. The procedure for trial of a warrant case by magistrate is prescribed in Chapter 19. See again, Chapter 19, the heading. Trial of warrant cases by magistrates. So, this chapter is applicable to trial in magistrates' courts alone. This warrant case, warrant trial. Chapter 19 in the Code. Though there are no sessions cases. So, sessions case, we know it is not, you cannot see this word sessions case in the dictionary. It is not defined, it is not used. but we can call it a sessions cases for our purpose. So though there are no sessions cases, a procedure for trial of cases in a court or session is prescribed in chapter 18 in the portion. So though there is no term used like a sessions case, a procedure is prescribed for trial conducted in a sessions court. That is seen in chapter 18. Since there is no cases described as sessions cases in the court, and almost all the offenses shown in the first schedule as triable exclusively by the sessions court, they are offenses punishable with imprisonment for a term exceeding 2 years. So, subject to some exceptions, all the cases which are exclusively triable by a sessions court are warrant cases. They are warrant cases. So they exceeded 2 years. So actually, warrant cases are being tried in sessions court. In sessions court, they are exclusively triable by sessions court. So they come under the definition warrant case. All the sessions cases actually come under the definition warrant case. So it is warrant cases that are being tried in sessions cases, in sessions courts. When a warrant case is tried in a sessions court, it is not the procedure prescribed in chapter 19 that is applicable. What we have to follow, that is why I told you initially that chapter 19 starts with the heading trial of warrant cases by magistrates. So when a warrant case, only warrant cases can be there, except this is summons cases. When warrant cases are tried in a sessions court, the procedure applicable is a different procedure that is given in chapter 18, trial before a sessions court. It does not say whether it is a warrant trial, it is a summons trial or anything. Any trial before a sessions case, the procedure has to be followed, but the procedure to be followed is given in chapter 18. Chapter 18. So it is a procedure with some differences in the trial of warrant cases. So essentially, warrant cases are tried in sessions court. It is not the warrant trial prescribed in chapter 19 that is being followed, but chapter 18. The procedure prescribed in chapter 18 has to be followed. But there are some differences. So the sessions trial is only a modified or extended sessions trial is a modified or extended form of warrant trial. So we have seen that basically there are only two types of cases recognized in the CRPC. They are warrant cases and summon cases. There is no question of summary trial cases or summary cases or sessions cases. They are not recognized, those terms are not recognized. So summons cases and warrant cases, but there are four types of trial prescribed. And these three actually take place in my state court. That is a summary trial, summons trial, and warrant trial. These three forms actually take place in magistrate courts and only in magistrate courts. But when we come to sessions courts, actually what happens is that trial is according to the procedure prescribed in chapter 18. So it means that when warrant case is tried in a sessions court, the procedure to be followed is not the procedure prescribed for trial by magistrates of warrant cases, but a different one. And basically there are only two forms of trial, just like there are only two classes of offenses, warrant cases and summons cases. There are warrant trial and summons trial, basically, only two forms. And summary trial is a simplified form of summons trial, and sessions trial is an extended form of warrant trial. These are the only differences. so far as this trial terms are concerned. So we have already stated that only one cases are tried in sessions court. This is ordinary rule only. We have said that almost all the offenses which are shown as offenses exclusively triable by sessions court are warrant cases. That's only an ordinary rule. There is an exception. Some summons cases are exclusively triable by sessions court. There are some summons cases which are exclusively triable by sessions court. They are offenses relating to defamation of the President of India, Vice President of India, then governors of the states, ministers, etc. They are punishable under sections 500, 501 small a, 502 small a IPC. The punishment prescribed is does not exceed two years. So they are summons cases going by the definition in the CRPC. So we have seen that almost all the offenses exclusively triable by sessions court are warrant cases, but there is an exception to it, that summons cases also can be tried. They are given in section 199. We have already seen. So it has already been stated that sessions trial is the only procedure prescribed for trial of cases in the sessions court. So whether it is a summons case, whether it is a warrant case, whatever it be, there is only one procedure prescribed, under the CRPC for trial in sessions court. If it's a trial in sessions court, only that particular form. There is no classification, just like a summons cases or the summary trial cases, etc. No trial, different trial. But there is an exception to it. Here also there is an exception to it. Section 237 of the Criminal Procedure Code mandates that the trial of offense of defamation relating to the President, Vice President, Governors, etc., as we have seen, covered by Section 199, Subsection 2 of the Code, they are triable in accordance with the procedure prescribed for a warrant case instituted otherwise than on a police report before a court of magistrates. So this so far as these offenses punishable under Section 500, 501 small a, 502 small a, relating to the President, Vice President, Governors, Ministers, etc., they are a totally exception to certain provisions. One is that though they are summons cases, they are exclusively triable by sessions court. Then, though it is the trial takes place in sessions court, the form of trial prescribed under Section 237 CRPC is a warrant trial, just like a warrant case instituted on a complaint, before a magistrate. So some exceptions are there so far as these offenses are concerned. Yes. So these are the differences between warrant trial and sessions trial, so far as the meaning of the terms are concerned. Now we have to come to the warrant trial procedure. Everybody knows. It may be a waste of time. Still, I will discuss some important points. For a trial of a warrant case, before a magistrate, different procedures are prescribed depending upon the institution of the case. Depending upon the institution of the case. If it is a case instituted on a complaint, one procedure is prescribed. If it is instituted by a police report, a different procedure is prescribed. So, a case instituted on a complaint is called complaint case. There is only one section which uses that term, that is section 210. Section 210 calls such cases complaint cases. Cases instituted, warrant cases instituted on police report, they are called actually police cases. So in a complaint case, after the complaint case means case instituted on a complaint. In a complaint case, after compliance with section 200 and section 202 CRPC, if the magistrate is satisfied that there are sufficient grounds for proceeding, then he must issue process to the accused. So we need not go into details of this inquiry. The process shall be accompanied by a copy of the complaint, if it is in writing, because we know that for to institute a valid complaint, the magistrate need not be in writing. Oral complaint also can be made to a complaint to a magistrate under the CRPC. Now, so when the accused appears in response to the process issued to him, the court hears and records the evidence for the prosecution. Under section 244 CRPC. Then the question before the magistrate is, after taking this evidence under section 244, the question before the magistrate is whether he should charge or discharge the accused. Whether a charge should be framed or whether the accused should be discharged. This is the question before the magistrate after the prosecution evidence is recorded under section 244 CRPC. If the prosecution has failed to make out a case which, if unrebutted, would warrant conviction of the accused, the court shall discharge him. So if no case is made out, no case, prima facie, no case is made out, then the accused shall be discharged. This is mentioned in section 245 on CRPC. So this accused may be discharged even before the examination of all or any of the witnesses. If the court considers the charge to be groundless. You can see IR 2009 Supreme Court 2282. But in the case of a discharge, it is the duty of the magistrate to record reasons. But if the magistrate is satisfied that there are sufficient grounds to proceed, then he should frame a charge against the accused. And unlike an order for discharge, in the case of charge, the magistrate need not record reasons. That is AER 2009 Supreme Court 2000 volume 1 SEC 722. 2000 volume 1 SEC 722. Maybe parallel AER citation may be also is there. Okay. So whatever may be the state at which the order is passed, the reasons should be recorded for discharge. But for charging the accused, it is not necessary to record any reasons. though some judgments say that some reasons should be given. Okay. Then one interesting question arises, whether the accused has a right of cross-examination at the stage of 244. At the stage of 244, that we can say that it is a pre-charge inquiry or pre-charge or pre-trial inquiry, it is actually called. So whether the accused has a right of cross-examination, because the section 244.1 uses the word, see section 244. When in any warrant case instituted otherwise than on a police report, that is a complaint case, the accused appears or is brought before a magistrate, the magistrate shall proceed to hear the prosecution and take all such evidence as may be produced in support of the prosecution. So the magistrate is actually recording evidence. If it is recording evidence and that is after the accused has ended appearance, whether the accused has a right of cross-examination, that was the question before the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court held that even at that stage, the accused has a right of cross-examination. That is AR 2009 Supreme Court 2282. So that means at the fag end of the trial after the charge is framed, exercising the power under section 319 CRPC, if additional accused is also made an accused, the procedure should start afresh. That means from the very stage of 244, if it is a private complaint. That is what the Supreme Court has said. That is the impact of that decision. Then, so we have come to the stage of a discharge or charge in a complaint case. Now, what about the police case? The police case, in all police cases, there would be an investigation and the statements recorded under section 161 CRPC also would form part of the final report. So the magistrate is, it is easy for the magistrate to ascertain whether a prima facie case has been made out. So that's why a pre-charge inquiry is dispensed with in the case of police cases. So in police cases, no pre-charge inquiry is held like the procedure prescribed for a complaint case. Section 244.1, 245, there is no such a procedure prescribed. That is the main difference between a complaint case and a police case in the case of warrant cases. In a complaint case, no evidence of the prosecution is recorded before the accused is charged or discharged. The court will only hear the prosecution and the defense on the question of a framing charge. So the magistrate has to decide whether the accused should be charged or discharged on the basis of the materials relied on by the prosecution in support of the police report. There is no pre-trial inquiry. That is the main difference. So if the magistrate decides to discharge the accused, okay, he is discharged. That is the end of it. If the magistrate decides to charge the accused, a charge has to be framed in writing, just like the procedure prescribed in a complaint case. So up to that stage, the difference is maintained. Only up to that stage, the difference is maintained. Without some exceptions are there, okay. So what's the procedure after framing charge? In a complaint case, as part of the evidence has already been recorded, that is examination chief and to some extent the cross-examination, if the adjudicator decided to conduct the cross-examination, what remains is further cross-examination of the witnesses already examined and cross-examined. And a witness has already been examined in chief and cross-examined under section 244, then under section 246, the defense has a right to conduct further cross examination. So there is a right of further cross examination. A second cross examination is permitted under section 246 and a re-examination. Okay, but if some witnesses were not examined, then they can be examined afresh. Also, that is also provided in section 246, subsection 5. So the witnesses already examined can be examined again, but that is a cross examination and re-examination, and new witnesses can be examined under section 246, 5, subsection 5 by the prosecution. That means by the complainant. Okay. In the police report case, police case, evidence of the prosecution will be recorded, as no part of the evidence has already been recorded. We have seen that there is no such procedure. Cognizance is taken on police report, and there is no recording of evidence before charge is framed. So there is no evidence at all when the trial starts. So all the witnesses have to be summoned and examined just like any other case. Now, trial in sessions cases. Trial in sessions cases. Magistrates take cognizance in warrant cases, that is, cases which can be tried by magistrates on police report or on a complaint. But section 193 says that, so far as a sessions judge is concerned, sessions court is concerned, unless there has been a committal of the case, a sessions court cannot take cognizance. So a sessions court can take a cognizance of an offense only when there is a committal order. Only when there is a committal order. There is an exception also here. Also, there is an exception, as we know. The complaint against the president, governors, etc. We have seen there is no committal is necessary. Because the magistrate can, the sessions judge can take a cognizance on a complaint of the prosecutor also. There is no difference. That is section 237(1). CRPC provides for this warrant trial. We have already seen it. A trial shall be held in camera at the request of either party or the court suo motu. Subsection 2 of section 237. So that is the only case where in a sessions case, sessions judge take cognizance without a committal. There may be some special statutes, that's a different matter. We are concerned only with IPC offenses. Now, whether the sessions court has the power to add accused immediately after the committal of the case and before evidence is recorded. The question here is, suppose in a case where the materials are collected by the police, reveal commission of an offense by one person or persons other than the accused. They are omitted to be shown as accused, either deliberately or because of negligence. They are not shown as accused. But the materials show that they are also involved in the case and they are also liable to be proceeded against. What is the power of the sessions judge? The contention was that as a sessions judge can take a cognizance of an offense only on committal, persons who are not included in the committal order cannot be added as accused on the basis of the materials relied on by the prosecution. Because as we know, in a committal proceedings, the only power of the magistrate is to examine whether the papers are in order and send it to the sessions court. The magistrate cannot do anything except that. It's just like a post office. That is what it is said. Okay. So the magistrate cannot add anything, add anyone to it. Even though the materials relied on by the prosecution reveal that someone other than the persons shown as accused in the case is also involved in the case. Then when it comes to the sessions judge, the sessions judge is not bound by the committal order. In as much as the sessions judge can take cognizance against the persons who are not shown as accused in the committal order, but who are involved in the case. This has been held by the constitution bench in Dharampal versus the state of Haryana, AIR 2013 Supreme Court 3018. Because there was a controversy, two benches differed in their views. One bench held that, okay, you have to wait till section 319 stage is arrived. So under section 319, the sessions judge can add accused on the basis of the evidence recorded in the case. So that bench held that is the only provision that is applicable, and the sessions judge has to wait till then, that is till the evidence is recorded, to add an accused who is not shown as an accused in is actually involved in it, which is seen from the materials related to the prosecution. But another bench held that is not necessary, because once a case is committed, it is not the accused that is committed, it is the case that is committed. And once a committal order is there, under section 193 CRPC, a sessions judge gets all the powers of an original court, a court having original jurisdiction. That means he can add one. If magistrate can do it, why the sessions court cannot do it? That was the question before the court. This was approved, Krishan's case, this has been approved by the Supreme Court in Dharambal's case, AIR 2013, Supreme Court 3018. So that power is there. The magistrate, the sessions judge need not wait till the stage of 319 to add an accused. If the materials relied on by the prosecution itself are revealed that he is involved in it. Okay. Now, in the case of, we know that a pardon can be tendered by magistrate under section 306 CRPC. And pardon is tendered under section 306 CRPC. Under subsection 4, that person should be examined as a witness by the magistrate. So once pardon is tendered by a magistrate, the person to whom the pardon is given shall be examined as a witness by the magistrate. That is what is provided in section 306 subsection 4 CRPC. But under section 307 CRPC, even though an accused was not tendered pardon till the committal of the order, committal of the case by the magistrate, a sessions judge can tender pardon. That power is given to sessions judge under section 307 CRPC. So after the committal and before the judgment is pronounced, a sessions judge can tender pardon to an accused under section 307 CRPC. In AIR 2000 Supreme Court 3352, the Supreme Court held that in such cases, there is no question of the sessions judge complying with subsection 4 of section 306. There is no question of examining evidence twice. That is what the Supreme Court has said. So in cases in which a pardon is granted by the sessions judge, section, subsection 4 or section 306 cannot be complied with. Cannot be complied with. That is one difference in a session stage, in a session trial. Now we know that under section 310 CRPC, local inspection can be conducted. This local inspection can be conducted not only by the magistrate, but by sessions judge also. By sessions judge also. Now, withdrawal from prosecution. Withdrawal from prosecution. Withdrawal from prosecution under section 321 CRPC. In sessions cases, even at the stage of committal proceedings, the prosecutor can withdraw from the prosecution. This was so held by the Supreme Court in AR 1957 Supreme Court 389. And later, in the dynamite case of George Fernandes, the former minister, you know, during the Janata regime, 80 Supreme Court 1510, AR 1980 Supreme Court 1510, the Supreme Court held that even at the stage of committal proceedings, in a sessions case, prosecutor can withdraw from the prosecution. Withdraw from the prosecution. Now, coming to remand. Coming to remand. Section, the subsection 2 of section 309 CRPC provides that a magistrate can, during the trial, a magistrate can remand an accused to custody only for a maximum period of 15 days. This is not during investigation, but during trial. 309 is applicable only during trial. Section 309 CRPC. The question here is, in a sessions trial, is it applicable? Is the sessions judge bound to comply with this subsection 2 of section 309? See section 309. Let us see. The first proviso to subsection 2, section 309. That no magistrate shall remand an accused person to custody under this section for a term exceeding 15 days at a time. Section 309 is applicable to both magistrate and sessions judge. Both are bound by these provisions in section 309. So the question which came up before the court is, the question that comes up for consideration is whether a sessions judge can send an accused who is in custody in a sessions trial for more than 15 days. That's the question. To answer this question, we have to examine the order passed under section 209 CRPC. 209 CRPC. That is the committal order. Clause B. It appears to the magistrate that the offence is trialed exclusively by the court of session. He shall, subject to the provisions of this court relating to bail, remand the accused to custody and remand the accused to custody during and until the conclusion of the trial. So, what does the magistrate do? What is the order passed by the magistrate in the committal order? In the committal order, he orders that or directs that the accused is remanded during and until the conclusion of the trial. So that means for the remaining periods, he is remanded. That 15 days is not applicable here to magistrate also. So when an accused is remanded during trial and until the conclusion of the trial, which takes place in the sessions court, is it necessary for the sessions judge to pass an remand order again? It is not necessary. So the question of the sessions judge remanding an accused to custody during the trial does not arise at all. So he does not remand him actually, because he is already under remand for till the conclusion of the trial. What does the sessions judge do? The sessions judge should record that the accused is sent back to jail. He is sent back to jail, and he shall be produced again on the next posting date, which may be beyond 15 days, or which may be beyond 2 months, which may be beyond 4 months, because he is already under remand by the magistrate till the conclusion of the trial. So that difference also we have to note. Now let us see some other differences, or the exact differences between a warrant trial and a sessions trial. See, under section 225 CRPC, section 225 CRPC, trial to be conducted by public prosecution. Trial before a court or session, the prosecution shall be conducted by a public prosecutor. Whether the case arose from a complaint or not, the prosecution of sessions case can be conducted only by a prosecutor. The complainant has no right to conduct the prosecution in a sessions court. So in a sessions trial, only a prosecutor is allowed to conduct prosecution, even in a complaint case, unlike in a warrant trial case conducted in a, before a magistrate. Then section 207. See, when the accused appears in response to summons or when he is produced, the magistrate has a duty to ascertain whether he has been furnished with the copies of all the prosecution documents, section 207. But when a case is committed to a sessions court, it is not the duty of the accused has been furnished with the copies of all the prosecution, all the documents relied on by the prosecution. The reason is this. There is a presumption that the statutory provision was complied with by the magistrate before the accused was committed, the case was committed. So it is not at all necessary for the sessions judge to ascertain whether section 207 was complied with. Section 209 clause A directs the magistrate to furnish copies of all the prosecution documents to the accused. Okay, so the magistrate is not bound by, the sessions judge is not bound by that section. Now, in a sessions trial, the custody of the, sorry, that I have already mentioned. Then, in a sessions trial, public prosecutor has a duty to open his case under section 226 CRPC. Unlike in a warrant trial. In a warrant trial, there is no such opening remarks by the prosecutor. There is only hearing of the both sides on the question of charge. Then, another difference. In a sessions trial, after the examination of the accused under section 313 CRPC, both sides shall be heard, unlike a warrant case or warrant trial. This is called a section 232 hearing. Hearing under section 232 CRPC. That is applicable only to a sessions trial, not a warrant trial. Then, in a sessions trial, the defense need not pay BATA to its witnesses. Okay. BATA to its witnesses. Section 233, subsection 3, unlike in a warrant case, warrant trial. Then, In a sessions trial, there is a provision for hearing the arguments of both sides after the evidence is closed. That is section 235, subsection 1. Unlike in a warrant trial. But there is a general provision we know under section 314 CRPC, a hearing is necessary. That also may be taken into consideration. Then, in a sessions trial, there is no provision empowering the court to order payment of compensation for false accusation, unlike in a warrant case, warrant trial. That is under section 250 CRPC. If the accusation against the accused was found to be false after the trial, the magistrate is empowered to direct payment of compensation by the complainant or the informant. This section is not applicable to sessions courts or sessions trial. But there is one provision in which, under which the sessions judge is empowered to grant compensation to the accused. That is the case of complaint case in relation to president, vice president, governors, etc. In that case, under section subsection 4 of section 237 CRPC, the court can order the complainant, that's the prosecutor, to pay cost compensation to the accused if the complaint was found to be false. These are the main distinction between a warrant trial and a sessions trial. Now, we can just consider these differences between summons trial and warrant trial also. In the case of summons trial, in a complaint case, no pre-trial inquiry after the appearance of the accused. So we have already seen that in a complaint case, if it is a warrant case, there should be a pre-charge inquiry under section 244 CRPC. Evidence is recorded. But in a summons case, even though it is on a complaint, originated on a complaint, no such a procedure is prescribed. Then two, framing of charge not necessary in a summons trial. That is in section 251. When the accused appears or is brought before the court, the substance of the particulars of the offense is read out. That is necessary. A formal charge is not at all necessary. But a framing of charge is necessary in a warrant trial. Sections 240 and 246. Then, in the case of summons trial, there is no provision to defer cross-examination of prosecution witnesses until and any other witnesses have been examined. But in a warrant trial, there is a provision to defer cross-examination of prosecution witnesses until any other witness has been cross-examined. Section 242, subsection 3, proviso. Proviso to subsection 3, section 242. Then, there is no provision enabling an accused to file a written statement after he is called upon to enter upon his defense in a summons trial. But in a warrant trial, there is a provision. That is section 243, subsection 1, reduce section 247. Then in a summons trial, there is no provision directing the accused here. There is no provision directing hearing of the accused on the question of sentence. But in a warrant trial, it is mandatory that before the sentence is imposed, the accused should be heard on the question of sentence. Subsection 2 or section 248. Now, in summons trial, accused may be convicted of any offense the tribunal has committed or proved he appears to have committed if no prejudice is caused to him. Even though it is not included in the particulars of offense, suppose it is made out in the trial that he has committed an offense, which is not included in these particulars particulars of offense, which are read over, still he can be convicted. Subsection 3 or section 255. But there's no such a provision in a warrant trial. It's a different matter that he can be punished for a minor offenses, which is provided under section 222 CRPC. But here in the summons trial, it is not a minor offense, but it's a different offense. Then, in a summons trial, accused may be acquitted for the non-appearance of the complainant, irrespective of the nature of the offense. Section 256. But in a warrant trial, accused may be acquitted for the absence of the complainant only if the offense is compoundable or non-cognizable. Section 249. Then again, coming to summons trial, the complaint may be withdrawn. Section 257. No such provision is there in a warrant trial. Then, under section 258 CRPC, in a summons trial, proceedings may be stopped at any stage of the proceedings. But there is no such a provision in the warrant trial. Then, in a summons case may be converted into a warrant case if the offense is punished with imprisonment exceeding 6 months, section 259. But no provision to convert a warrant case into a summons case. If it started as a warrant case, warrant trial, then till the end is a warrant trial. There is no question of converting it into a summons trial. On the other hand, in summons trial, it can be converted into a warrant trial. These are the differences. Then summary trial, actually, it is not necessary for us. So these are the differences between sessions trial and warrant trial, between summons trial and warrant trial. Some minor differences may be there, which we need not discuss today, because it is available here. Only thing is that some provisions, sometimes we may not take notice, just like this is section 199, offenses of defamation relating to or in respect of a president, vice president, etc. is an exception to many provisions. A complaint case is tried by a magistrate, by a sessions judge, and it is a warrant case, unlike other cases. Then there is a provision for payment of a compensation. These are all exceptions. So unless these exceptions are there, I think there is nothing new in the procedure. So far as this trial is concerned, whether it is a summons trial, summary trial, warrant trial, or a sessions trial. So the thing to sum up, there are only two types of cases, warrant cases and summons cases, but there are four types of trial, that is sessions trial, warrant trial, summons trial, and summary trial. But basically, there are only two forms of trial also. That is the summons trial and warrant trial. Summary trial is the simplified form of summons trial, some modifications, some restrictions. Then, sessions trial is the extended form of a warrant trial. Some modifications are there, some additions are there. So, these are the four trial forms of trial. But with regard to the procedures, there are some differences. We have already noted, especially the remand of accused who is in custody. The sessions judge never remands during the trial an accused who is in custody. He only sends back the accused to jail because he has already been remanded during and until the conclusion of the trial by the magistrate by his committal order. Committal order. These are some differences with regard to the approval also. I have already given you remand in this. There is no question of a sessions judge complying with subsection 4 of section 306 when pardon is tendered by him and not by the magistrate. So these are the main differences. Okay. Then another aspect I have to say is with regard to the sentence. In a sessions trial, there is no question of or there is no restriction with regard to the limit of fine that may be imposed by the sessions judge. Sessions judge. That is, okay, this is not mentioned here. Then, Section 26 of the CRPC, it gives power to a sessions judge to try any offences, under the Indian Penal Code. Indian Penal Code. Suppose a magistrate commits a case because his view is that it is a case. So he commits. Then when it reaches the sessions court, the sessions court is of the view that the materials do not disclose commission of any offense exclusively tribal by a court of session. So it's applicable. Section 228.1 says that the sessions judge may frame charge and then send it after recording the plea, send the case to the chief judicial magistrate or any magistrate, any judicial first class magistrate. This is the provision in section 228 subsection 1. Okay. Suppose a sessions judge finds that there is no case exclusively tribal by him. Can he try the case instead of sending it to a magistrate or CJM? See, the Supreme Court has held that a sessions judge is empowered to try any offense under the IPC. That means even the simplest case, he can try up to murder. There is nothing wrong in it. So the sessions judge is not bound to send the case to CJM or the magistrate. He can try the case himself, even if it is a case of section 323 or 304A. There is nothing wrong in it. Yes. Okay. So these are the distinctions between these four or three different forms of trial. If you have any doubts, I shall try to clear it. Or if I do not know it, I will study it and give an answer later. Yes. Then how can the question I did not actually, the last part, yes, of the sir. Question, 162.
Sir, I will read the questions. In fact, I had muted myself. Yes. So that there's no disturbance.
Sir, an accused was brought before the magistrate on arrest.
I will read from the first question. This is by Sachinanand. What is the scope of Section 258?
Section 258 arises only when it is a summons trial. Section 258, just to see what does it say. In any summons cases instituted otherwise than upon a complaint. So, two requirements. One, it is a summons case. Second, it is a police case. It is a police case. If it is a complaint case, that is not applicable here. Then, of the proceedings at any stage without pronouncing any judgment. Suppose the magistrate is satisfied with the examination of one or two witnesses that it is a false case, he can stop it. That no offense is made out. It was by mistake he took it on file. Then he can stop it under Section 258. There is nothing wrong in it. These are the situations covered by, ordinarily covered by Section 258. Yes.
Yes, sir. This is. What is the importance of Section 226 of CRPC in the sessions trial by Sarvapalli Legal?
226.
Yeah.
Okay. 226, actually, it is a summary of, it shows how the prosecution proposes to prove its case. It enables the prosecution to satisfy the court or to show the court how he proposes to prove the offense against the accused. What is the purpose? So that he can regulate the proceedings before him. The magistrate, the sessions judge can regulate it. Supports the magistrate, or in the nature of the case, the sessions judge is satisfied that. An expert witness should be examined first. After hearing this prosecution under section 226, he can say that, see, you have shown this witness as a number 10. You examine this witness as a 220, as a first witness, so that it is a convenient for the court to appreciate the evidence or to control the trial. That is the purpose of section 226. How the prosecution proposed, that is to enable the court to control its proceedings further. Yes.
This is Muhammad. If the accused wants to seek further investigation, then can he seek further investigation after the committal, or he should seek before the committal?
See, now the Supreme Court has held that, under the Bhai Patel's case, the Supreme Court has held that after cognizance is taken, the magistrate has no power to order further investigation. The only power is with the investigating officer. So there is no question of praying for further investigation after cognizance is taken. Yes.
This is by Ritu Ponta, assistant professor. Why session trials is a modification of a warrant trial?
That's right. Basically, the structure of the trial is the same. Some modifications, just like this public prosecutor. I have mentioned that those differences I have already given you. Except those differences, everything is the same. You are examining the witnesses, read in examination, hearing your attendants. Basically, the same thing. Some differences which I have already given, minor differences. The public prosecutor alone can do it. Then section 226 is there, opening case. Except those are minor changes, nothing. Warrant trial.
Okay. Sanjay Vadwa, under which provision an accused in CRPC, like in applications are made under 151. Of a CPC?
No provision. You cannot make an application, because except the High Court and the Supreme Court, on the criminal side, the courts have no inherent power. 482 is applicable only to High Courts, not subordinate courts.
So, this is by Azad. Whether a magistrate of first class has the jurisdiction to frame charges for offenses punishable for more than 3 years, example 504, 506. If he frames the charges, then what is its the legal position?
Charges necessary if it is a warrant trial. Necessarily it is a warrant trial because it is a punishable with imprisonment exceeding 2 years. Then it's a warrant trial. Charges necessary. Then what is the rest of the question is?
So the rest of the question is, if he has framed such charges, then what is the legal
charges framed?
Yeah.
The charges framed, then what is the effect? It is a notice to the accused. Charge is a notice to the accused, as to the points or the as to the facts which would be proved against him, the offenses which would be proved against him, so that he may not be taken by surprise. That's all.
This is by Vikas. Quashing of the FIR before submission of the final report was dismissed with the observation. quashing of the FIR before submission of the final report was dismissed with the observation that prima facie case is made out, but also observed that same grounds of quashing can be taken before the trial during the framing of charge. Can discharge application still be moved in such a case?
See, when you pray for quashing the case on the basis of FIR, no other material is before the court. What can be the argument when the FIR is sought to be quashed? That the FIR does not disclose commission of any offense. That is the only thing you can ask for. But on the other hand, when it is the stage of framing charge, all the materials are before the court. So the magistrate can decide whether all the materials relevant by the prosecution disclose commission of offense. So the purposes or the basis is entirely different. That's the only difference. Otherwise, the power is the same. Discharge. Here it is quashing. Yes.
Section 162 CRPC bars use of Section 161 statements.
Yes.
Otherwise than provided there. Then yes. How can the statement of 162 be used for the purpose of taking cognizance of framing of charge?
So, see, CRPC provides, CRPC gives the procedure to be followed. But 162, though it is in CRPC, it is a rule of evidence. It is a rule of evidence. On the other hand, in section, it's not a rule of evidence. Section 227, it's not a rule of evidence. It is a rule of procedure, simple procedure. That's the difference. So we cannot confuse between these two provisions. Yes.
This is by Upinder. Police filed the final report in the Sessions case before the GMIC court, and on protest petition of complainant, the case is committed to the Sessions court. Who has to open the case? Either the police prosecutor or a complainant?
See, you have already seen this. Under Section 225 CRPC, there is no question of a complainant prosecuting a case. Only a prosecutor can do it. But when there is a case and counter case, different prosecutors should appear for the prosecution. That is what the Supreme Court has said. The same prosecutor cannot appear in case and counter cases. So there is a case and counter case before the sessions judge. Then there is no question of the complaint prosecuting it. That also can be prosecuted only by a prosecutor, public prosecutor. The only exception we have seen, that is under Section 199 CRPC, that is prosecution for a defamation of a president, etc., etc. That is the only case where a complaint is tried.
This is in a summary trial. Will any of the stages like chief, cross be skipped compared to full trial?
Yep.
In a summary trial, in a different basic question would be in pith and substance, what is the difference of the procedure in a summary trial and a full trial?
Summary trial. See, the procedure in summary trial is the procedure specified for summons trial subject to following modifications. Only some modifications. One, it is sufficient for the magistrate to record the substance of the evidence. Section 264. He need not record the evidence, the deposition. It is sufficient that after records the substance of it, but it does not take place anywhere. Otherwise, the bar will not actually will not allow it. So that does not take place anywhere. I think B, only a brief statement for the reasons for the finding is sufficient for judgment. Brief reasons. A full-fledged judgment is not expected. Section 264. Then, maximum sentence that may be imposed is 3 months. 3 months. These are the differences between summary trial and summons trial, otherwise same. Particulars of offense is red dollar. Yes.
In a complaints case, who opens the case in the sessions court?
See, that is why I said that under section 225 CRPC, only a prosecutor can do it. No other person is entitled to. See, section 301. Section 301 also can be read along with the section 225. 301 CRPC. The public prosecutor or assistant public prosecutor in charge of a case may appear and plead without any written authority before any court, etc., etc. Two, if in any such case, any private person instructs a pleader to prosecute any person in any court, the public prosecutor or assistant public prosecutor in charge of the case shall conduct the prosecution. So even when a complaint case, when it reaches before the sessions court, it can be conducted only by a public prosecutor, but the complainant can instruct the public prosecutor. Then what does it say? And the pleader so instructed shall act therein under the directions of the public prosecutor. So the Supreme Court has said that he is just like a junior of a senior advocate. What will junior advocate can do? He can only obey the instructions of the senior advocate. That's all. He can whisper something into his ears. Nothing else. He can give some instructions. See, this is the fact is entirely different. Or some instructions may be given with regard to the witnesses, etc. He cannot conduct prosecution. Under no circumstance, a pleader can conduct a sessions case. Only public prosecutor. Yes.
So we will only take two questions because questions will continue to pour in once you are given so much insights. When can a person or accused file an application for stop proceeding in a summons or a non-complaint case?
When can you file an application under section 258 in a
summons and a non-complaint case?
Summons and in a non-complaint case, that is police case.
Yeah.
We have already mentioned it. There may be circumstances where the state happen to take a cognizance of funds actually which is not revealed. By mistake, he read over it. Take the case of section 294 small b. It is necessary that the obscene words should be uttered near a public place. The prosecution has no case that the place of occurrence is a public place or near a public place. Still, the magistrate happened to read out the particulars of the offense, though offense is not made out. The magistrate took notice of it only after the trial started. He can stop the proceedings. He can say that it was by mistake, cognizance was taken. The materials relied on by the prosecution do not disclose commission of the offense under section 294B. So the proceedings are stopped. Yes.
Yeah. Mohammed, can session judge order further investigation if accused is seeking for it under section 173 sub clause 8?
No, there is no question of the session judge as of now. I don't know whether the judgment will be or a different view will be taken later. Because now what the Supreme Court has said is that a court cannot order further investigation after taking cognizance. It is all in the realm of police.
So it is akin to what is in labor court, we say functus officio. Unmute, Johnny. Sir, we are unmuting you. Okay. Sir, now do it. Now we have allowed it to do the unmuting part. Yes, sir. Yeah. So the last question is, an accused was brought before the magistrate on an arrest under section 306, 324, 506, and 509. Can the magistrate delete section 306 by stating that there is no ingredient made out and bail is granted?
Section?
306. Can he say that this is not made out and he grants the bail?
Section 306.
Yeah.
CRPC.
Yes. IPC, he says. Sir, an accused was brought before the magistrate on arrest under section 306, 324, 506, and 509.
Right.
Can the magistrate say that ingredients of section 306 are not made out, therefore bail is granted under 324, 506, and 509?
The magistrate can only ascertain whether the papers are in order. Suppose 306 was shown by mistake. It was shown by mistake. Okay, the magistrate can say that it is a mistake. But he cannot go into the merits of the case and say that the offense is not made out. Suppose 306 is shown by mistake. Suppose it is not 306 but something else. Then he can say that it is a mistake only. In such cases, there is no problem. But in other cases, he cannot say that section 306 is not attracted because he cannot pass such an order.
Yeah. So, thank you, sir. As I said, the questions will continue to pour once the speaker is such who is able to share the knowledge on wider aspects. And what we shared at the first instance, that people would be enriched by your knowledge, and that was actually what I said at the instance. Even at the end, I will say that we have actually learned a lot of things. And friends, before we part for the day, tomorrow's session would be Careers and New Challenges, Thought Processes and Attitude for 21st Century by Dr. K. Siddhartha, Strategic Thinker in Perception Management, Consultant to National and International Government Agencies, and moderated by Professor Puneet Sharma, who is also an anchor at Doordarshan National. And from all the participants who are watching us live on the Facebook and on this platform, it was a fascinating session, and on their behalf, I'm thanking Justice Abraham Mathew. As usual, what we say, it was a spot-on session. We all got enriched by the insights given by him in a short span of time of 1.5 hours. But to give in a capsule form only speaks volume of his knowledge to decimate in the fashion that which everybody could understand. Thank you once again, sir. And everyone, stay safe, stay blessed. And tomorrow we will connect at 4 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Meet again.